I can't remember when my obsession first began. I think it was right before high school.
One morning, I accidentally moved the dial on my clock radio.
What's happening?
And instead of being pummeled out of bed by the usual love lyrics and electric guitars, I was awakened by the most extraordinary music. Music without words that spoke to me more powerfully than anything else I had ever heard before. I was being initiated into a world of sonic subtleties and complexities I had never known. I stayed glued in bed until the magic was finished.
That was the beginning of my musical gluttony. Beethoven was the bait. The New York Public Library for the Performing Arts was a musical playground where I could indulge my insatiable appetite for free. Bach, Haydn, Mozart, Beethoven, Brahms, Wagner, Debussy, Ravel, you name it, I left no masterpiece unturned. But my lust for newer and weirder sounds knew no bounds, so naturally I headed for the forbidden zone.
I began to accept the fact that I had a deviant ear, a queer ear, an ear for eerie music.
But one name in particular grabbed me. It stood out from the rest. It sounded made up, make-believe, like it was lifted from a wacky children's book. That name was Milton Babbitt. I mean, what could the music of someone named Milton Babbitt possibly sound like?
I took the record home. I thought to myself, this guy's got to be kidding. Nobody from this planet could dream up stuff like this. It was unlike any music I had heard before. Nothing repeats. There weren't the familiar gestures or landmarks of traditional, or even not so traditional, musical form. I didn't know where it was going, and I didn't know where it was coming from.
It's blasphemous and wicked.
So I kept on listening, and listening, and listening.
I can't stand the guy's music. It's icky.
Several months later, something clicked. I began to sense a complex design of intervals, rhythms, and contrapuntal textures. Babbitt's music has the prismatic beauty of a multifaceted crystal, which reflects and refracts, focuses and disperses light of varying intensities and colors in unpredictable ways.
I find it extraordinarily thrilling, stimulating, exhilarating music.
I got lost and wasn't able to attend the second three-fourths of the piece.
Do I necessarily hear the things in Milton's music that he would like me to hear? No.
One critic has even commented that the music of Milton Babbitt is so dense that each moment contains as much information as an entire movement of a Mozart symphony. It's extraordinary, really.
I felt that his music penetrated my brain, even altered its neural pathways. I could finally say that I liked the music of Milton Babbitt. In fact,
I love the music of Milton Babbitt!
I wondered if there were others out there, like me, who were as excited about Babbitt's music as I was.
Have you heard of the music of Milton Babbitt?
Who?
Milton Babbitt.
No.
Milton Babbitt. Have you heard of the music of Milton Babbitt?
Have I what?
Heard the music of Milton Babbitt.
No.
Milton Babbitt. Milton Berle.
Who?
I've heard of John Babbitt. Or is that John Bobbitt?
The guy who got his dick cut off.
Have you heard of the music of Milton Babbitt?
No, never.
Never? Why
never.
Not?
Milton Babbitt.
Probably don't listen to enough radio.
Is it on the radio or is it on television? Is he new? Is he old?
He's been new for the past 50 years.
Oh!
Is he signed? Is he even a signed artist?
He's an American composer.
Mm-hmm. No. Oh?
Milton Babbitt? Is he related to Bruce?
Absolutely not.
May I ask you a question? Have you heard of the music of Milton Babbitt?
No.
What music do you listen to then?
Hip-hop.
Prince and Lenny Kravitz.
Stuff.
Beastie Boys.
Jazz. Everything was good.
Kiss.
Everything but German folk music.
I listen to everything except Milton Babbitt. I've never heard of him.
Does he play weird jazz?
Perhaps it's too intellectual for us.
I was locked up with a person named, his last name was Babbitt in Massachusetts.
Bring me a demo.
Maybe he's got a bad agent. Is he in here?
Have you heard of the music of Milton Babbitt?
Yes, actually.
Do you like it?
Yes.
Come over here. Wait.
I don't wish to be rude, but I'd rather listen to Beethoven.
I was shocked. I mean, how could these people not know who Milton Babbitt is? I mean, you know, Milton Babbitt. I mean, something's wrong. Something's wrong with this culture. Babbitt should be a household name like Madonna or McDonald.
In fact, I consider Milton the culmination of the great B lineage of music history. Bach, Beethoven, Brahms, Babbitt. You see? It even sounds good. Who is Milton Babbitt? What is he? Born in Philadelphia in 1916, Milton Babbitt received his early musical training in Jackson, Mississippi, where the conventions of a Southern musical education were inescapable.
Listen to the song of the metronome.
Since it was not proper for a young boy in the South to play piano, only girls did that, he took up the violin. Babbitt's first public performance was at age 5, playing the Bach two-violin concerto from memory. A local newspaper called him a whiz kid who had perfect pitch and could add up all of his family's grocery bills in his head. Though he intended to continue playing the violin, Babbitt became interested in the music of jazz pioneer Bix Beiderbecke. He immediately took up the clarinet so that he could perform in jazz bands. Soon he was playing gigs every Saturday night. Milton Babbitt evokes extravagant critical responses. His position has been described as the furthest extension of the romantic ideal of the Promethean independent artist who flies free of the earth and its compromises. He has been accused of fanatical scientism, a search for quasi-logical precision of reference, with an undertone of distress, even rage, and is said to be possessed by a fine madness. Babbitt has been regarded as the charismatic figure perhaps most responsible for a mountain of unlistenable academic exercises that did so much to inspire the widespread belief that all new music is repellent pedantry. In any case, his work has extended the musical universe in a multitude of directions and has taken it near to the boundaries of human conceptual and perceptual capacities. He has been hailed as the protean creator who has taken us near to the heights of contemporary intellectual accomplishment. I wanted to find out more about his music, where it comes from, how it's put together, how it works. So I headed off to Princeton University.
Every morning I would say hello to Hutch, and he would say hello, and he would nod his head. I was in his house once, because his violist in his string quartet was Theo von Laue, whose father was a famous physicist in Germany who made a deal with Hitler that he would work for the Nazis if he would let his son out. And his son came over here and lived with Einstein. How do you like that for a tale? This is where I lived through a great part of the war. I can discuss that with you later. Mm-hmm. And, of course, Einstein had an office here until the Institute built its own building, and that wasn't until later. So when you say, you know, did you know Einstein? The answer is, sure, I saw him all the time. So did everybody else.
I think the university has been, in Babbitt's thinking about American musical culture, absolutely key.
You know, I was teaching mathematics through a great part of the war, in addition to going back and forth to Washington, doing what I can't tell you about.
Babbitt saw the university as a place that could provide a kind of almost aristocratic patronage for composers, and at the same time, here was the home of the bastion of free speech, so that it would be a potential home for the most original things, the most experimental things, without worrying about commercialism.
You are becoming just a merchant, Mr. Cashman.
The public likes my stuff.
Evidently. You have new clothes, hand-painted cravat. But is your work the best, as good as you can do?
Of course, not yet.
Or are you just making a fortune?
What's wrong with a fortune if it helps me get on?
Come here, my boy. Look. This is Franz Schubert. He was a songwriter, too.
That's the old library where I lived a great part of my life. The very old and wonderful library where if you went to get a book out, you'd find yourself attacked by rats. This is where my academic life began, 1938. It would have begun in 1937. Should I tell that now?
Yeah.
Well, I was studying with Roger Sessions privately in New York. I'd been studying with him for 2 years after graduating from college. And in 1937, Roger became an assistant professor here. Neither he nor Oliver Strunk, these distinguished people, had tenure. They were just assistant professors without tenure. And I was the only one of Roger's students who had done the academic thing in music, who had an academic degree in music, of course. And he said, you know, we would like to offer you a position at Princeton. I said, fine, I'd love it. You know, after all, I came out of universities, I'd love to go back. And the universities in those days had no composers. And I said, fine. Then it occurred to me, knowing Princeton and knowing the Ivy League, where I'd spent the first 2 years of my life, I said, Roger, are you aware of the fact that I'm Jewish? No, it never occurred to him, because after all, my name is Babbitt. He didn't realize the German origins of the name. I came from Mississippi, which indeed I do. He said, well, I'm sure it won't make any difference. He came back a week later and said, well, of course it doesn't matter to the chairman or to any of us, but the chairman feels it wouldn't be good to have the first young appointment to a Jew.
Richard Wagner, at rehearsals of his great opera, Rienzi, Richard Wagner hid in the wings while the singers ate their lunch. He didn't have a lunch, just dreams of the music of the future.
And that's what it was. The following year, the person whom they appointed instead of me didn't work out very well. They offered me the position, I accepted it, and it started here, 1938. That's all there is to that.
Mm-hmm.
I never encountered anything whatsoever of the slightest. My whole life at Princeton, it would smack of anti-Semitism any more than I did in the South. But the students, of course, would suffer. Who's kidding whom?
Of course.
The club system?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, no question about it.
He is one of those people who, in Richard Pell's book about the intellectual developments in the 40s and 50s in America, he refers to a certain kind of Jewish intellectual as the one who can talk faster, think faster, and generally deal faster with all sorts of problems than anybody else. And I remember reading that passage and thinking, this is Milton Babbitt. Of all the people I know, this is Milton Babbitt.
Composers like to say, I'm not a university composer, I'm a composer who happens to be in a university. He happens to be in a university because it makes it possible for him to be a composer, otherwise he wouldn't eat. And I can't imagine a more important function than being able to eat occasionally while you're composing music.
He can eat the spiciest possible food. I'm not as good as he is. I usually have a lot of rice to cut it.
I don't eat anything that's fat-free.
The only composers I ever knew were fat little men with bald heads.
The notion of being an academic composer was normally regarded as a term of dismissal, of course, a pejorative. You're an academic composer. Well, I mean, in any other field, the most demanding activity, the most intellectually, I don't want to say respectable, but the most informedly problematical, the most responsibly advanced activity took place in the academy and could take place virtually nowhere else and was not encouraged anywhere else. Everything militates against the composition of demanding, difficult, intricate music.
He never asked himself, is this a hit? He said, this is the way it must be done.
It's always interested me that he's one of the few avant-garde artists, and I think genuinely avant-garde, who's had an academic career, which is to say he started teaching at a young age and continued to teach and got himself a chair and whatnot. How has this happened? This is supposed to be inconceivable, and in fact it is inconceivable.
I've made the connection with the medieval period where music, mathematics, geometry, astronomy were taught in the university. Music was then an intellectual discipline.
That there are deep connections linking music to science and mathematics has been known since the foundations of modern science were being laid by Galileo, who was a musician and a musician's son, and Johannes Kepler, who upon adducing the mathematical laws governing the motions of the planets declared, "I discovered among the celestial movements the full nature of harmony." It was frequently alluded to by Albert Einstein, himself a violinist, who called Niels Bohr's model of the atom the highest form of musicality in the sphere of thought.
At the RCA Research Laboratories in Princeton, New Jersey, they have built an electronic device that makes music. It's called a synthesizer, and it never causes teenagers to riot. This is the RCA Music Synthesizer, a wild, improbable tangle of copper wire, buttons, relays, switches, lights, and dials. The size of 20 grand pianos, cost about $750,000, said to be able to make electronically any sound that can be made by a full orchestra of union musicians and some that can't. Professor Milton Babbitt of Princeton University is its trainer and keeper. He is expert both in music and electronics, and he explains what it is all about.
It was possible to control rhythm in every sense of the word, not only rhythm in the usual sense of temporal durations and succession of the combinations into ensemble rhythm, but rhythm in the sense of time rate of change, of timbre, of register, of dynamics, of all the dimensions of music becoming parts of rhythmically related aspects of music.
We shall now perform the same excerpt on the synthesizer at twice the speed. Remember, on the synthesizer, a change of speed affects only the speed of the excerpt, not, as the phonograph record would have done, change the frequency as well. Now, it might be asked why all of this electronic mastery has been marshaled just for the purpose of creating nothing more than music. There are at least two important functions. The first, and for all of us, the most important function is that of musical composition.
To get back to the essence of why we went into electronic music, there was the rhythmic aspects, the temporal aspects, the complete control aspects, but there was a practical aspect. We could walk into that studio with the composition in our head and walk out with the finished performance and the tape under our arm.
The second aspect is that of research. For this instrument can be used singularly appropriately for research into the nature of sound and the nature of the perception of sound.
And I learned things there that I had never learned before. I learned how we hear much more than I could have learned under any other conditions. After all, the hand is never faster than the ear, but electronic speeds are much faster than the ear. Electronic discriminations are possible which are far beyond the discriminatory capacities of the ear, and we're using the ear metaphorically, of course, the musical mind, the musical perceptual capacities. We learned, of course, that what we were dealing with now was not the ability of the performer, but with the ability of the auditor. And that's what interests me. So of course I care how you listen, because in this case we're talking about what you can hear, how you can discriminate, above all, how you can construe.
Unfortunately, there have to be concerts, even with electronic music, because we too have our performer problems, and our performer problems reside in speakers and equipment. And I hate to think of what sound of this kind sounds like coming out of home equipment or television equipment. So we do have concerts, we have had concerts where we can control this sound exactly as it's produced. Eventually, of course, we would look forward to the time when everyone will have equipment that meets our specifications and would be able to perform this music. In that case, I, for one, would be deeply relieved
because I would not have to go to concerts, I would not have to go under specified conditions with specified people. I could listen to music when and if I felt like it, and repeat it if I felt like it, and I take it that any intelligent listener agrees with me.
That last selection is called Composition for Synthesizer, written by Dr. Babbitt. And it's a good example of the other extreme, mechanical music made by a machine that'll never cause any juvenile riots. Nor will it ever sneeze during a concert, play a sour note, or spill coffee in the piano. But it does take the blood and humanity out of the music and replace it with a kind of chilly perfection.
Do you have a methodical approach to your composition? Do you have a set time when you compose and a set place when
you
compose?
Oh, no, Robert. No, definitely not. I'm a very sloppy guy. You've seen the way I live. No, I mean, I don't say this boastfully at all. It happens to be true. I can compose anywhere.
You're safe, and that does it.
I've composed on... Well, my wife drives the car, and I have composed in the car very often. I can compose anywhere. I compose here at Juilliard. I compose in my office at Princeton. I compose at home. No, I can compose anywhere. First of all, because I don't need a piano, number one. And number two, simply because once I get an idea, look, it's the same old story. I get better ideas about the piece walking through the streets of New York than I often do sitting home and concentrating. You have an idea of a piece, you don't have an idea for a piece, you don't have a detailed theme, you don't have anything of this kind, you don't have something that will work into the piece, though some composers might, but I don't see how you can start today without having the idea of a piece, the relation of some detail to the totality, or how the totality will subsume that to those details. You have to think of the relation between, if you wish, the small and the large, the microcosm and the macrocosm, those cliched words, before you can even sit down to write. I mean, I have seen examples in our greatest composers, and that includes Schoenberg, who got this wonderful idea for the beginning of the piece, wrote down all the details on the first page, every aspect of the instrumentation, of the dynamics, and everything. The piece never got beyond that, because they hadn't thought about the continuation of the piece and the total piece. They couldn't go on. You asked me what put my mathematical mind. Explicitly, nothing. Implicitly, how can I tell? I don't know whether because of the certain amount of training that I had in mathematics and my interest that I had always had in mathematics might have done something to my mind, might have shaped it, might have affected it in some way, though it might have led to my observing certain things. But I looked at it as a purely musical phenomenon, as a relationship among pitches and rhythms and all the things that are really musical resources.
Let's look at this array for a moment. You see these numbers and say, oh boy, mathematics again. I don't have to dispel this ridiculousness about this being mathematical music. Many because it's called 12-tone. It's like saying he's 21 years old, therefore he must be a mathematician, because 21 is a mathematical term. It's a well-known fallacy. Schoenberg couldn't count up to 12 without taking off his shoes.
When I heard the fourth quartet of Schoenberg played for the first time in 1937 at the New York Public Library in a lousy room with the Fifth Avenue buses going by, Elliott was there, by the way, at the same performance, the Polish quartet playing in its own out-of-tune way. I heard enough in that piece immediately to run out and get Felix Greisler to get me a copy before it was published in the Schoenberg Fourth Quartet, because I knew the things that I wanted to look at. I suddenly felt able to infer such extensions, such personal extensions of those resources, that I began to simply again generalize them.
But the notion that you begin with a mathematical statement and somehow interpret it in musical terms is, of course, preposterous. What we did do is look at the music, begin to construe it, and arrive at certain ways in which we could generalize. You take these numbers, oh boy, doesn't that look mathematical?
These are just intervals.
I hate to say this, it sounds like a Philistine, but you don't listen to a piece of music to infer a mathematical formula.
There's no question that Babbitt can be identified as the father of serial music in the United States.
There's an interesting dichotomy about intellectualism and serialism and 12-tone writing in the fact that it's conceived intellectually, but the more organized it gets, the less intellectually it can be perceived. So that when you get to total serialization, basically speaking, it is anti-intellectual in the listening process. How the piece is built is cut off from the listener.
I personally find all of the details of his music from moment to moment quite lovely. But if you ask me 30 seconds later how it connects, I often have a lot of trouble. For me, Milton's music is very much at the surface from moment to moment.
Musical structure resides in the memory of the beholder. I'll never forget the fact that when I was 2.5 years old, and I know I was 2.5 because it was the end of World War I. You remember World War I? And my parents took me in Lincoln, Nebraska to a park to celebrate the end of World War I. The armistice had just been signed. And as we walked away, I heard what must have been a band in the background from a band shell playing Till We Meet Again. I can never forget that as long as I live. If you can't remember where the piece has been when you hear the present event, you have, in a very realistic, I would say even in a very scientific, or in a very, I would say, psychological sense, you have genuine random music.
If you want to get colored pencils and trace it, you can trace it. And it's all accountable. And all of Milton's music is accountable to everything, to every specific degree of timbre, you know, duration, volume, as well as pitch. But you can't hear it. Music needs repetition.
The piece is full of repetitions, or I should say recurrences, but very few recurrences. Literal recurrences do occur, but I think what they're thinking of.
His entire oeuvre, his entire career, is similarly a constant progress of renewal of his basic concepts and techniques. With the wonderful result that each piece is, in fact, brand new. I mean, he doesn't repeat himself in any sense, not in a given piece, but even from piece to piece. And I am amazed at how he finds, particularly at his advanced age now, still new ways of shaping, of structuring his pieces on new premises, which nonetheless come always totally out of the basic 12-tone concept.
He gives us a clear role model of what it would be like to simply write the kind of music you want to make, no matter how hard it is for audiences.
What does anybody know about the mind? Hardly anything yet.
We know about him, don't we? We know he's a man of genius. What is it like to have such a thing inside you? All your life, something inside you that wants to come out, that wants to sweep the earth. If only he were mediocre, how easy it would be.
Of course, playing with the term minimalist, he has identified himself as a maximalist, that he tries to put as much information into a work as possible. He does.
It must be hard being the most complex composer who's ever lived. Inevitably, you make unreasonable demands on people you don't even know.
When you're composing, you not only have to think ahead, you have to think behind. And you think of taking in this whole piece and that particular note at that time. The other thing I would add to that is, you know, I mean, I want to make every note count, but I don't do it by counting notes.
I heard that number you were playing. It's all right.
Did you really like it, Bill?
It has the smell of originality. Heaven knows that's rare on these premises.
Babbitt is somebody who conceptualizes music in ways that are very original and in ways that finally... you know, force you to reevaluate everything you've thought.
This is certainly not music that is designed to get in one hearing. This is music that is designed to be heard a number of times with increasing awareness of what happens.
Haydn's symphony, for example, was designed to be gotten at first hearing by its audience. So the audiences in London in the 1790s who heard Haydn's symphony, no matter how complex its structure, got it right away. They laughed at the joke. They were surprised at the interruption. They recognized the relationships, and so forth and so on. There is no audience like that really alive today, and therefore a lot of the music is written with the assumption of recording and repeated hearing. We're operating in an entirely different context about listening.
Rather than think of it as highly difficult music, I think it's worth it to just open up to the piece, whatever it happens to be, and realize that, in fact, the perplexity that, you know, may greet a listener who's expecting something that sounds like Dvorak or something like that, is that it doesn't conform to what you thought music was. And that if you open yourself up to the fact that, well, this is a new kind of musical experience that I'm going to have here, there are many, many things that you can plug into pretty quickly, which don't require lots of advanced, you know, degrees in music. It's not, you know, you don't need a PhD to listen to this stuff. And, you know, the kind of thing, Babbitt, because of certain things that are going on technically in the pieces, there will be, in many, many of his pieces, a very fast-moving and interesting play of registers and textures. Things move around from high to low in really interesting ways.
Happy to be involved with music of our own time, and specifically Babbitt, and also the idea of working with a living composer.
As Crazy Stengel once said, people my age are dead.
Someone who's alive and can actually comment on his music.
You're just part of an ensemble, and most of these words are there for their sonic value and for what they do. Don't worry about the clarity of those upper voices, you know, those upper notes which you can't really make clear. You can almost half speak them if you'd feel more comfortable. Give some intimation of pitch and then almost Sprechstimme. That's entirely up to you. I was perfectly well aware of the fact that I placed vowels up there that you can't possibly articulate. It was just the timbral aspect, because these people will all have this putative poetry. No, look, it's terrific. And look, you know, Brad knows as well as I do the details have got a little off. It's always going to happen. We've all played together too much for that. It won't be that way the next time. You'll make worse mistakes.
And that the listener is cognoscenti, an insider who hears the sound as it relates to itself without thinking about pretty pictures, dying elephants, great sunsets, much less the sort of romantic movie music kind of idea where you're thinking about, you know, the great love, the great death, the great catastrophe.
Anyway, I don't want to imitate nature. I want to capture its very essence. So that all the birds and the beasts died tomorrow, and the world became a desert, when people heard my music, they would still know, feel, what nature was.
If you look at the first program notes of the Vienna Philharmonic in the 1890s, for example, they'll give you a linear description of the events. It's not about counterpoint, it's not about any structural issue, it's about this happens and this happens and this happens, sort of it's reduced to a single line of the story. You know, boy gets girl, boy loses girl, finds girl at the end. I mean, that's what music is about. Well, it's reducing music to kind of trivial accompaniment or to a kind of storyline in the linguistic sense. Well, in the late 19th century, a kind of elite, a self-referential elite, a group of people who talked to each other and taught one another, were sort of appalled by the Wagnerian success. All these Philistines came in, and after a lot of repetition, they finally knew the leitmotif. Bom, bom, bim, ba, ba, bom. You know, they finally, they heard it, and they, this is it, And this meant death, it meant love, it meant Siegfried, it meant, and this really was a kind of madness, which really the followers of Brahms, which includes, of course, kind of what we'd call the conservative school historically, people like Reger and so forth. And Schoenberg, of course, said, of course, this is not the way music ought to function. So when he, in the First Chamber Symphony, for example, he says, look, I've eliminated repetition. I've eliminated all the tricks of hearing that the audience has gotten used to, right? And I've condensed the form. And furthermore, my real master is not Wagner, my master is Brahms, because Brahms truly is the composer of intricate, self-referential puzzles.
There's this compounding of the, shall we say, the proleptic and the analeptic, that which is to come and that which is preceded, recalling and intimating. I mean, there's nothing more remarkable. You know, for me, the great composer in that respect is Brahms, as you full well know. I mean, the opening opus 18, number one. I can never stop marveling at the things that go on there, that intimate, that are, that seem contradictory.
I'm hungry.
Man, no great music when he hears it.
That particular barbarian happens to be Johannes Brahms.
When the Fourth Symphony is written, for example, his friend Elisabeth von Herzogenberg writes him and says, wait a minute, do you realize, is anyone going to get this? Is anyone going to hear this? In other words, it's so wonderfully put together, it so evolves out of itself, out of cells of units, of fragments of pitch relations, ideas which then evolve in this fantastic, landscape of sound. For Babbitt, I think complexity, emerging from simplicity in a way, is one of the wonders of music. And that is what is realized in his best music. And he's ambivalent. Clearly, he would like everybody to stand up and cheer. But what the language of music that's going to get people to stand up and cheer is essentially violating the true nature of music, and also conceding to a kind of Philistine taste.
The people make the choices. You see, I don't understand the morality that would insist that it is more moral to stoop to conquer the masses rather than to set a standard to which they might aspire.
I have a kind of fleeting popularity which people are willing to pay for. What I do is here today and forgotten tomorrow. But you create, Robert. The things you do will last forever. If they don't make money today, that's not important. You must be free to write your music.
Music to which no men will listen.
Music which the angels will be proud to sing.
I think Milton Babbitt's work seems very abstract, almost like an abstract painting.
What I mean by abstract is he doesn't coordinate different musical elements in a way that is based on, our learned language of music.
It used to be said even by my friends, we didn't realize you wrote such abstract music. I think that's, again, what we were talking about before, that at that stage, at least when the four instrument piece was played, people called it abstract music. I don't know what it could have meant, but they couldn't find an immediate relationship to other music, other more familiar music.
He disassociates the different parameters of music, such as pitch, rhythm, etc. so that you can't use it rhetorically like a language before. And instead, he reconnects everything in his own way in each piece.
They used the term autotelic to apply to the new, what we would call abstract painting. Autotelic, same thing as what we would say in music is automorphic. We like the term. That's the term I prefer to contextual. Automorphic, it creates its own form.
It seems to me what he's trying to do, or what he's done, is make it so that each new piece defines its own new grammar, its own new language.
It's very inaccessible.
Oh.
It seems the structure isn't anything that I can relate to. You know, it's nothing like you were saying that we've heard before.
That at first appears to be an undifferentiated continuum. And it is true that Milton's music may, on first hearing, appear to be just that. I think there's a young man who once said about his piano concerto, which is a wonderful piece, said that, well, if I put the needle here or there, I'm hearing the same thing. Well, all right, that's perfectly reasonable, and I say I am very interested in non-differentiation. Every time I look at Jackson Pollock number one or something, I do say, wow. However, on second, third hearing, the nuances of differentiation become apparent. And I believe there's very little music other than Milton Babbitt's about which that can be said.
Part of the fun is listening to it lots and lots of times, because I'm thinking of the one piece we're working on. I listen to it lots and lots of times, and sometimes I get it, you know? I feel that kind of, he's thinking, you know? There's thoughts in there.
My brain is very comforted by his music. And
artists aren't.
It is. I often find music annoying. I have
a
totally untutored ear, and so my response is always visceral. And what I find is that my brain is stimulated by Milton Babbitt's music, and my heart is touched by the freeing of my mind, which is a different way to have one's heart touched than usual. And in that way, I find his music extraordinary and unique.
Babbitt does it, you know? You don't have to necessarily like his music, but you can say he's really...
I wasn't engaged. I mean, I literally almost fell asleep.
But isn't human life abstract? Isn't your life abstract?
No.
I like anything, any kind of art that's abstract, because I can laugh.
Yeah, it would almost take like an insect to dance to Babbitt.
I just wish that we could have entire programs of Milton Babbitt music, because that would be all pleasure and no pain.
Yeah.
Good night, Robert.
Nothing Milton Babbitt will write or has written will be the soundtrack to the bicentennial celebrations, the way in which Copland. Here is this homosexual Jewish man from Brooklyn who has written the emblematic music of the American landscape and never been on a horse, never had a 10-gallon hat, but somehow used a vocabulary of music without, in my view, any kind of cheapness. I mean, this is a great composer. Uses music to unlock a soul, in a way, of a nation that doesn't really know itself, recognize itself, the way Johann Strauss did, for example.
Da-da, da-da, da-yum, bum-bum, da-da, da-da, da-yum, bum-bum, da-yum, bum-bum.
I think that German Romanticism led to, in a sense, the evolution of the 12-tone system, which led to serialization, and everything that leads to that kind of organization is, to me, a Germanic trait, compartmentalizing, organizing, understanding everything, accounting for everything.
In response to the concept that Milton might be Germanic in his way of approaching music, you'll forgive me, but I would basically characterize that as piffle.
So you took a European idea and made it American by pushing it to extremes. And I've argued, this goes back 30 years now, that the American imagination at its best does take European ideas and push them to extremes, or did. That was the American way.
In fact, Milton Babbitt is so American that he even copies out his music in front of the television, watching baseball.
Baseball was the only game whose ground rules, whose boundary conditions were reasonable. I mean, baseball has deteriorated, I won't say like almost everything else, and that would be the old man speaking, but it is the old man speaking.
He loves jazz, you know.
Leading the way to a new and significant form of musical expression that is typically American.
There is a complete lack of what Morty Feldman used to call angst.
Really swings. I think that's partly the key. If you don't understand that in Milton's music, you can't really perform it.
To explain serial technique to a lay audience in a pre-concert talk, and I sort of laid out how 12-tone technique worked, and then said, look, now we carry it further. Serial music is taking that kind of organization and putting it to everything, putting it to the color of the instruments, putting it to the way they attack notes, putting it to how long they hold notes, to the volume they hold, and all of those are happening in various permutations at the same time, and it sounds like random music. Therefore, if you try to hear Maestro Boulez's music and understand it and think of theme and development and all the things that you bring to other pieces, you will be confused, angry, and disappointed.
In my view, in the serialists, is that they got too self-referential. They got hermetically sealed, which happens with cadres of groups of people, if you want to speak sociologically, who talk to one another, develop their own rules.
20th century music is like pedophilia. No matter how persuasively and persistently its champions urge their cause, it will never be accepted by the public at large, who will continue to regard it with incomprehension and repugnance.
That it cannot be dismissed, but it can therefore not have spun itself into a corner by which it has, bears no relationship with the gestures or significance of life. The 20th century development in music somehow spun apart on its own track under the influence really of the Schoenberg 12-tone direction. And its Americanization became a kind of a school that that cut its own path, but a quite a lonely one.
I feel lonely.
Milton received a commission from the New York Philharmonic to do a big piece for the orchestra. He called it Rallada 2. It was a continuation of a work, Rallada 1, that he had done a few years ago, before that. And it had to do, the title had to do with philosophical principles. In any event, it was an extremely complicated piece. It was a piece by Milton for full orchestra. And the first rehearsal was absolutely chaotic. It was conducted by Bernstein. The score was just filled with errors, and Bernstein had to stop every second to correct the errors. And Bernstein finally said to Milton, you know, dare we go ahead with this? I'm not sure that I'm quoting exactly, but certainly a reasonable paraphrase. And Milton said, of course we can't go ahead with this. It's a terrible mess. I think there is some kind of perverse pleasure that Milton gets in stomping everybody and making them unable to deal with what he produces.
I knew they wouldn't listen. I could have told you that.
Oh, we don't care. We'll show them. I'll show them right now.
That kid's got something new.
In 1946, he tried to write a Broadway musical, and Mary Martin was supposed to star in it. Didn't work.
A little unusual for popular music, isn't it?
And I always wonder what would have happened if it had played. on Broadway and been a fantastic success. Would he have dropped what he had already begun doing, which was serious 12-tone writing? Or because it failed, did he say, they think that was complicated, let me show them what's complicated, and then go back to this material and write works that are so abstruse and recondite?
You know, I have encountered a variety of infatuated women in my time. None so far has had the effrontery to suggest that I would employ my music as an instrument of revenge.
The question is, if Alma Mahler were alive today, would she pursue Milton Babbitt? Perhaps, but not without a fight from Sylvia.
I'm going to co-opt two of the more irritating complaints that have been leveled not only at Babbitt's music, but at 12-tone music in general. Roughly put, and that is all they deserve, they are, one, that stuff all sounds alike, and two, there's no real composition here, no room for the composer. Once you have a row, all decisions are made for you, or forced upon you. I'm sure you've all encountered versions of these and ones like it at one time or another. And lest you question the currency of the coinage, let me just tell you that I heard the second one asked of me by a student on Monday.
Hey, I would say that there's a lot of confusion maybe about 12-tonery, which Milton has so articulately advocated, and Milton as a very crotchety, idiosyncratic composer who's got certain musical itches that he's scratching like crazy that come out a certain way, and that his particular slants on how to work with pitches feed all the time. But it's not as if there was this thing called the 12-tone system, which dictates Milton Babbitt style of music.
There are moments in his music when little things happen, little ditties and stuff will happen, where, you know, I'll say, wait a minute, no. You know, no self-respecting person in the modern, serious, classical world who's trying to impress their peers would ever put a little ditty like that in their song, you know. At best, they would have to say, well, this is just kind of a local occurrence that happened as part of the unfolding of these larger structures that I was working out, and so forth. But, you know, I think about it, and I listen to it, and I say, no. Milton put that little ditty in there because he wanted that little ditty in there, and he wanted it to sound, however it came off, cute or funny or shocking or whatever, he wanted it to sound that way. And so there's another level that's in there that I think often gets missed when you're overwhelmed by his theories.
But how that theory affects me? Well, of course, it affects me deeply, but I'm never conscious of it when I begin to compose, obviously. I don't depend upon theory in that sense. I hope I've internalized it, and I can never depend upon theory to help me out of a tight place. I get stuck. I get stuck by not, you know, I wanted to do this, but really can it be done? Sometimes one is stuck only because of the limitations of instruments, and I'm no longer with the electronic instrument, with you're never stuck. Or I'm not quite so sure that I want to do now what I thought I wanted to do.
But I am writing the music that I would most like to hear. I can't imagine any other criterion. When I choose a note, I choose the note that I think is the note, not by virtue of any external criterion. Now, again, we're not going to talk about mathematics or anything else in the world. The criterion, a purely musical criterion of choosing the note that I think goes there and which should be there, and I'm doing it, if you wish, in that sense for myself. But to say that that's self-indulgence, I guess the only thing I can answer is that there's no one I would most prefer to indulge except me.
What would you call it? The will to create?
only with my music that I can prove my right to live.
Did you ever know Robert to stop and retreat in the face of anything?
If you imagine music history as a single crack on your living room wall, with that mistress of medieval monophony, Hildegard von Bingen, somewhere over here, and that master of postmodern polyphony, Milton Babbitt, somewhere up here, you get a picture of music history that, while being accurate, is not the whole story. Because if you pull back and get the broader view and see the entire wall, you notice that there's not one crack. There are many cracks, hundreds of cracks, thousands of cracks, in fact, an infinite number of cracks. So while this line leading from Bingen to Babbitt is valid, the story is more complex. Babbitt actually represents a complex intersection of many cracks coming from all directions, below and above. And that's what makes his music so rich.
Theory in the world can explain the fact that his music does have life in it. And when you hear it, even if you don't understand, even if you don't like it, you're gonna react to it. It's got a life quality. And there's no theory, not even Milton, can come up with a theory to explain why that is.
You're a brilliant artist, Franz. I envy you. I wish I had the power to translate the commonplace into such stupendous experience. Once in a while, though, a little moment comes along which seems to defy such translation. Do you know what I mean, Franz?
Why is anyone a great composer? Why is Beethoven a great composer? Why is Schoenberg a great composer? No, I mean, I think...
The point is that no matter what we think about Milton Babbitt's music, its origins...
There are no two songs...
Is it the product of the 12-tone system?
Songs were
cracked. Are the notes generated from a mathematical model? Is his procedure too rational? Too precise?
And those are not available because those...
Ultimately, Milton Babbitt's music comes from his imagination. Milton Babbitt's music is a way of imagining music, a way of imagining a possibility of how music can go.
They would have to simplify them.